So, sir, I just given an introduction. Even everyone is excited to listen to you. People are started asking about the book names and everything. So I'm sure that you know we will discuss that. But to start the session, I humbly request you to take over the screen.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Nikhil, for inviting me. And thank you, everyone, for joining on a Saturday morning. I have a small confession to make. I can't understand Malayalam, so I'll do the whole discussion in English only. So please bear with that. But in case if you have any queries or questions in Malayalam, I think Nikhil is an able, he's agreed to translate it for the mutual benefit of me as well as you all. So with that, let me just start with a presentation, a few slides. I'll try to keep it as brief as possible. The subject, is this quite deep, and if we really want to get into it, I used to do full day workshops, roughly 8 hours of time, and still it appeared incomplete. So it's another thing that we need to keep in mind. I'll still try to do as much justice as possible, and that's why we thought let's keep a Q&A format. Whatever questions that you may have, please keep typing in the chat box, and we'll try and cover as many questions as possible. Before we start, all mutual funds start with a disclaimer that mutual fund investments are subject to market risk or past performance may not be sustained in future. Similarly, I'm starting this program with a disclaimer that this is not a get-rich-quick formula. This will not help you select the best mutual fund, because according to me, there is no such thing as the best mutual fund. We only select mutual funds which are appropriate for our given situation. And for the same person, the situation could differ from time to time. And for different people, at any point in time, the situation could be different. So to that extent, it is all about selecting appropriate mutual fund schemes to help us in our situation. So that's why the focus is going to be towards that. And third, this program will not make you the best investors. In fact, just to go on the same lines, and I'm not sure how many of you are expert investors and how many of you are not experts. But I consider myself as somebody who's still learning about how to invest my money properly. And I've only spent 27 years in this industry. So that's the depth of the subject, and it's a journey that we all do. What happens with such kind of programs, the workshops, is that it allows you to think and take proper decisions. And because this is only restricted to one small part of the portfolio called mutual funds.
Life is excellent.
So because it's only restricted to a very small part of the your investment plan, that's why I'm saying it's not going to make you the best investor. Having said that, compared to gold, real estate, equities, shares, or debentures and fixed deposits, mutual fund is actually a service offered by a professional investment management firm that does the entire investment management function on your behalf. So I have a choice whether I buy stocks myself or I give money to an equity mutual fund manager who then takes those decisions and manages the money. So it's not a choice of stocks versus mutual funds. It is, should I do it myself or should I give it to somebody else? And this point is very relevant for, especially in the context of what we are talking about, best investors. Because if you are the best investor, then you don't need an expert to manage your money. Then you can do it yourself. So this program is not going to make you the best investor, but it'll help you understand how the fund management is done by various managers. And you know, to that extent, it'll help you choose a manager in a better way. So that's the context. So what does this program do? It actually offers you some simple steps of constructing a long-term portfolio using mutual funds. Now I've added two words out here, long-term. Okay, so far I not used this phrase long-term. And there is a reason why I'm talking about long-term portfolio, because essentially the basic purpose of investing is to live a life of our choice. And assuming that we are going to live long life, we have to build the portfolio. In the financial markets, it is said that there are two risks that any individual runs as far as life is concerned. One is to die too soon, and the other is to live too long. And that's where, as a protection against financial protection of the family against the early death of an earning member, there is a life insurance policy. And for the other risk, which is living too long, that's where the investments come into picture. So I'm looking at only that part of the portfolio. Having said that, if we have to construct a long-term portfolio, there are three basic steps that you know, we need to keep in mind. It's a simple three steps that I could you know, think of. We are going to focus more on using the second and go beyond the second and third steps actually. But you start with first taking care of the immediate term and short term needs. Only then you can take care of the long term needs. So take for example, if I want to invest for next 30 years, then I need to ensure that whatever are my requirements in those first 30 years, I have provided for it. Otherwise, I'll be regularly withdrawing money from my long-term portfolio. And at the end of 30 years, I might have no money or at least a deficit compared to my requirement. So to that extent, first you have to provide for the short-term and medium-term needs, and then look for long-term. And then in the as far as the long-term is concerned, first we define our financial goals, long-term financial goals. What are these long-term financial goals? And you, many times you might have heard that we talk about, you know, buying a house, funding the retirement, getting the kids educated, et cetera, et cetera. So these are known as financial goals. But just stop here and think for a moment. In all the cases, all we are talking about are expenses which are going to take place in future. So all the financial goals that anybody talks about in majority of the cases are deferred expenses, expenses which are going to take place sometime in future. And if that's the case, we need to ensure that the money is invested in such a manner that sufficient amount is available to fund those deferred expenses called financial goals. Now, once you defined those financial goals, I mean, you may have three goals or you may have 300 goals, whatever your list, it is going to be your personal list or your family's list. So this is the first one, which links back to why we talk about appropriate funds and not best funds, because each family's financial goals may be different. Each individual's financial goals also could be very, very different. So to that extent, a portfolio has to be personalized, and that personalization can happen either by yourself or with the help of an advisor or a mutual fund distributor or various other names which are spoken about in the industry. So with that professional's help, you can prioritize your goals and look at various solutions. But while there is a need to fund those expenses, there are certain risks that we need to take. And in order to take these risks, we need to understand what the risks we are talking about, primarily at the investor level, let's understand that if I do not want to take any risk at all, if I want to invest in something which carries zero risk, what is the option? So for that, let's understand the broader risk when you give your money to somebody, which is investment. In the process of investment, you have to give money to somebody, be it a bank, be it a mutual fund, be it a company where you invested money or government of India or whatever it is. But when you give your money to somebody, risk number one is, will you get that money back as promised on time or not? That is risk number one. Risk number two, what if the value of that investment keeps going up and down over the period of time? I mean, we've seen gold prices fluctuating. We've seen property prices going up and down. We've seen stock prices going up and down. So that is the second risk. First is, when I give money to somebody, I may or may not get it on time. That's the risk. Second, the value keeps going up and down. So I invested 1,000 rupees. After some time, the value could be 900 rupees, or the value could be 2,000 rupees, whatever be the case. The third risk is, while the money is absolutely safe, there is some operational provision because of which I can't touch my money. Like, let's take, for example, if I put my money in PPF account, public provident fund, safe, no question about it. But within a certain period, I cannot touch that money. I can't withdraw that money. So that is the liquidity problem or risk. So we talked about first credit risk, second fluctuation risk, and third liquidity risk or illiquidity risk. If I do not want to take any of these risks, then all I can do is I can keep money at home under a mattress. Liquidity, anytime I can access, will somebody give it back or not? I have not given it to anybody, so there's no question of getting it back on time. And number three, will the value fluctuate? No, it doesn't fluctuate. A 100 rupee note lying in my house is a 100 rupee note. But the problem with that is, the money which is lying under the mattress in my home, because the value does not fluctuate, the value doesn't even go up. Whereas the cost of various goods that I want to buy, the expenses that we talked about, the cost of those expenses keep going up, which means the money lying at home loses purchasing power, known as the risk of inflation. And because of that, we need to take a combination of the first three risks in order to meet our future financial goals. So this is where risks have to be taken. And if risks have to be taken, we need to understand how much risk do we need, how much risk we can take. I mean, we are able to take. So it is all about my need and my ability. The third is, psychologically, how much risk can I handle? So that's my willingness. And that's where the risk profile comes in. Now, this, last two are very critical steps that are required, and a lot of advisors spend a humongous amount of time helping their investors in arriving at what we call asset allocation. So we'll just quickly touch upon that. But before that, let's look at the immediate and short-term needs. And the immediate and short-term needs can be taken care of by looking at these four things. First, take care of your short-term, expenses, and also create a contingency fund. So this contingency fund typically is 3 to 6 months of family's expenses. Take enough amount of health insurance and life insurance, and also provide for all the loan repayments that you may have, the liabilities. So once you've done that, that's taken care of the immediate and short-term needs. Then you take care of your medium-term goals by using various savings vehicles. And then the next point comes in, which is where we talked about, in slightly detailed way, your financial goals and risk appetite would help you arrive at how to divide your money across various asset categories, which are nothing but equity, debt, gold, and real estate. How do you divide your money between these four? And for that, the four risks that we talked about, risk of price fluctuation, risk of credit, risk of illiquidity, and risk of losing purchasing power or risk of inflation. Those four risks have to be kept in mind, your own risk profile, and the risk associated with various asset categories. So I'm not getting too much into detail of asset allocation, but this was just the background for asset background for launching the discussion on scheme selection now. Once the asset allocation is defined, then the schemes, mutual fund schemes within that asset category need to be identified. The most common approach that a lot of people use in mutual fund scheme selection is looking at the past performance, and in that past performance, the various things that are evaluated are how much returns various schemes or categories have generated in the recent past. If there are any independent rating and ranking agencies, what are their star ratings or ranks or whatever, that's often taken into consideration. A lot of times expert opinions on various schemes or scheme recommendations are also considered. And if there are any awards that any schemes or fund houses have won, of late these awards are something that we don't really hear a lot about, because SEBI came up with a regulation where mutual fund companies cannot advertise the awards that they've won. So that's something that is less talked about today, but the first three still remain. The problem with this approach is very much there in that standard disclaimer that you read in all mutual fund communications: past performance may or may not be sustained in future. So what do we do? We don't have anything about what the future holds. All we have is the past, and we have the current portfolio. Within that, should we completely ignore past performance? Well, no. But for that, let's look at a slightly different business to understand how to evaluate past performance. And this is cricket season. The fourth test match is being played right now as we speak between India and Australia. So let's take an example of a cricket match. This is how it looks. There's a game going on somewhere. I'm just describing the photograph. And the bowler, bowls the batsman is trying to play that ball. But the ball takes the edge of the bat rather than hitting the middle, and the ball goes in the slips. However, the slip fielder is unable to hold onto the ball, and it goes through his hands, goes outside the boundary line for 4 runs. Now imagine a situation that there are two friends who are watching this match live. But while this particular delivery was being bowled, one of the friends got up to fetch a glass of water, whereas the other was glued in front of the TV screen. The second friend, when he came back, all he saw was an extra ball was bowled and 4 extra runs were scored. He said, "Wow, wonderful. The batsman hit a boundary." The guy was sitting there, he said, "No, the batsman was lucky." Okay, now it's the same thing which has happened, but different inputs. And the interpretation of the whole thing was different. And this is exactly what happens when we look at performance of mutual funds. So let's now compare these two mutual funds. First of all, the second friend who had gone to fetch water was only looking at the scoreboard, and he did not actually see what happened at that particular moment on that delivery. This scoreboard in the context of mutual funds is nothing but the NAV that you see, or the returns that are highlighted in various websites or wherever you see. That's the scoreboard. It does not tell you how that boundary was scored. Was it the batsman's superior batting ability, or was it luck? And this is something that can only be seen when we see what happened. And what happened is known as the investment process. And in order to understand that investment process, two things are to be seen. One, what are the risks that the fund manager is taking? and how the portfolio is constructed. Now, before we move on further, let's also understand a few things. The mutual fund as an industry is highly regulated. And by highly regulated, what I mean is SEBI has put very strict structure regulations about what kind of schemes and how do they launch, etc., etc. Now, for each scheme, these details are available in a document known as the scheme information document. You may only refer to a smaller version of it, which is available with the application form called Key Information Memorandum. So you go to any mutual fund's website and only download the Key Information Memorandum for a certain scheme. And if you read that, that would tell you how the fund manager intends to play the game. So let's say in the cricket match, if I understand, Jasprit Bumrah will bowl in a certain manner and Kuldeep Yadav would bowl in a certain manner. Kuldeep Yadav cannot bowl like Jasprit Bumrah and Jasprit Bumrah can't bowl like Kuldeep Yadav. So these are like individual schemes. So, of course, they don't come with a scheme information document, but in case of mutual funds, they have to come with a scheme information document and the management team has to follow that document to the T. They can't really deviate from it. And that's what allows us to understand the process, what kind of process they are going to follow. Having said that, over a period of time, we can evaluate the performance, how somebody has behaved by actually looking at various things. And I'm going to very briefly talk about some of those things, but this is important. Having said that, even when you got two fast bowlers in the team, you know how to compare a Jasprit Bumrah with a Navdeep Saini. Both are right-arm fast bowlers, but both are different. And that's where, though each fund house has got some processes, you also got to look at the individual fund managers or the management teams. So team of players is also equally important. Process is one, team of players is another. But just keep an eye on the fund expenses. These are equivalent of the extras that a bowling team gives away, the buys, no balls, etc., etc. So just keep an eye on fund expenses also. Lower, the better, but not always necessary. And from that, let's move on to scheme evaluation. A few parameters that you may want to look at, but before that, the few key points that you've got to remember. And if you want to just take a snapshot of this page or copy this, by all means, please do that. But the first line is something that is very regularly highlighted. Remember that cricket match, a batsman who hit a boundary on that ball, how often can that batsman repeat that? And that's where past performance may or may not be sustained in future. If it is skill-based, it is repeatable. If it is luck-based, you're not sure. I mean, there have been instances where, there was one particular match, I exactly forget which game it was, but in that game, we had Sachin Tendulkar, Rahul Dravid, Saurav Ganguly, those kind of batsmen. And in that match, Saurav Ganguly actually got out for duck. But in that match, Ajit Agarkar, who's actually in the team as a bowler, he scored a century. So that can happen. And still, Tendulkar, Ganguly and Dravid are far better batsmen than Agarkar. So if you simply look at one small period of mutual fund performance, let's say last 1 year or last 3 months or last 3 years, and decide that this fund is the best, sorry, it could be a wrong thing to look at. Very often the fund or the fund manager could have gone simply lucky during that period. What you should try to do is look at consistency. I will come to consistency in a while, but before that, leading on to that, just because there was no loss, it doesn't mean that no risk was taken. Risk was taken, it just that it did not materialize somehow. Third, various parameters are evaluated, and a lot of experts keep talking about various parameters. I'm not making this a technical session, but even when somebody is unable to see the risk, it does not change the basic nature of equity markets or debt markets or property market. Take, for example, between 2010 to 2019, I'm talking about 1st January 10 to 31st December 19, so a 10-year period, equity markets fluctuations were muted. The if you look at the stock market index, Sensex, then the fluctuations would look very, very muted. And a lot of people started believing that, the equity markets have become safer because of lower fluctuations. And then 2020 happened. And those of you who are investing, you know what happened between January and March, and then March to December. We saw huge fluctuations during this entire year. So suddenly, people were shocked what happened. No, we should have been shocked what was happening in those 10 years, because by nature, equity markets are supposed to see price fluctuations. And if those were not visible, that does not mean that markets have become safer. It just means that markets are behaving in a deceptive manner. So there was risk, but numbers showed something else. So this is another point that we need to keep in mind. And fourth, fund managers must take some risk, because every fund manager who's managing a portfolio actively aims to beat the benchmark index, aims to outperform the benchmark index. And in order to beat the benchmark index or outperform it, you got to do something different from the index, which is where certain risks are taken. And let's take a deep dive into some of the risks. But before that, risk is always a choice. So for a fund manager, it's a choice whether to take risk or not. For you as an investor, it's a choice whether to take certain risks or avoid certain risks. And because of that, mutual fund scheme selection is all about selecting schemes on basis of risks. And for that, SEBI has taken some amazingly forward-looking steps. Two, according to me, are very critical, and you may want to study these further. But first of all, SEBI categorized mutual fund schemes. There are 37 different categories within which schemes can be launched. And in those categories are reasonably well defined by SEBI, so that there is no ambiguity. If you are comparing a large cap equity fund across fund houses, you expect that there will not be major differences between that. They have to behave in a certain similar manner. It's like a fast bowler in a team has to bowl fast. He can't start bowling spin, or a wicketkeeper has to stand behind the wickets. So that's where the categorization and these rules, this is part of the SEBI rules now. The second is the riskometer. It's a 6-scale meter which SEBI has come up with, and that allows you to compare schemes within the category. So pick up a category. Once you decide the asset allocation, then you decide the category. Then within that category, you decide which is a riskier scheme and which is not. The riskometer gives you one number out of, there are the 6 numbers. So one is the lowest and 6 is the highest. Risk one is lower risk than risk two. So within a category, you may see which one do you pick up, 5 or 6 or 3 or 4. It's not going to be 2 or 5 mostly. This is the riskometer that I was talking about. Low is called 1 and very high is called 6. Okay. So within that, you can decide, do you want to really take those risks or not? And that decision must depend on, number one, how serious are you about a goal? So let's say if I were to take a decision for funding my daughter's education, if that's my goal, then that's a very serious goal. And I would try to keep the risk on a lower side. But if the financial goal is about buying another car, then I don't mind taking a higher risk. So even if the risk materializes and I don't achieve my goal, I would regret much. But if I can't fund my daughter's education, I can't afford that. And this is precisely my thinking. Each one's thinking could be different. For somebody, education may be primary goal. Somebody may look at retirement as primary goal. For somebody, leisure may be a primary goal. Somebody may look at funding the, starting a business could be a primary goal. Each one will have different priorities. That's why the goals need to be prioritized and you add the riskometer to take that decision. Now, while looking at equity funds, we talked about past performance. So a few things to keep in mind is, of course, outperformance with respect to or in comparison to the benchmark. If you are striving for that, does the scheme outperform the benchmark or not can be one of the filters. However, it is impossible for all the funds to outperform the benchmark. And number two, it is impossible for any fund manager to consistently and always outperform the benchmark. So there will be some ups and downs. Don't simply remove a fund because of one or two periods of underperformance, but look at longer periods. And what is longer? So first of all, look at each calendar year. For example, the non-overlapping is what I meant by non-overlapping is you look at different periods. So how did the fund do in 2016, in 2017, 2018, 2019, 2020? In five different years, what happened? 2019 will have no impact on 2020, so to say, or a limited impact that way. But you look at these kind of periods and then do the evaluation. But when you do the evaluation, look at appropriate benchmark. So each mutual fund scheme has a benchmark defined in the scheme information document, or you can go to the fund fact sheet and the benchmark would be mentioned over there. So that's something that you can do. Also look at various bull and bear markets in equity. So let's say last year's January to March, the Sensex and Nifty dropped by around 38 to 40%. During that period, how did large cap funds behave or subsequently what happened? So you can look at those kind of market cycles and do the comparison. And that's where in a rising market, how much did the fund rise the capture? So what was the upside capture or what was the downside capture? So when the markets fell, how much did the fund fall? More than the market or less than the market are some of the comparisons that you can do. Now, this is, this may get a little technical difficult, not technical really, but difficult in devoting enough time. Because some of you may be busy in your schedule, but then I can't find a shortcut to this. Risk measures are given like standard deviation, which measures volatility, the fluctuation, and beta. So both are actually measuring the fluctuation. So you may want to look at which schemes have done bigger fluctuations or lower fluctuations. And during the same period, if you're comparing two similar schemes within the category, then this could be easy. The third is drawdown. Drawdown is nothing but the steepest fall that you witnessed in that particular scheme or particular category. What is the maximum from top to bottom has been the fall? And then you can do a comparison. It gives you a sense of how much are you willing to how much pain are you willing to see, if I were to put it that way? It's not a loss, it is a drop. The difference between drop and loss in case of equity markets is drops happen as a nature of equity markets, but losses have to be booked by selling when there is a drop. Okay, if you don't book it, a lot of times a diversified portfolio of good quality stocks bounces back. So drop and loss, do you want to see the drop or can you wait? So that's where the drawdowns come in. I'm not explaining the Sharpe ratio right now, but essentially it tells you, and these numbers are available, Sharpe ratio, standard deviation, beta are available in the fund fact sheet. So that's why I mentioned. Sharpe ratio tells you for every unit of risk, standard deviation, how much was the return generated in the past. So that's a good way to see if somebody took the risk, was there a commensurate reward or not? But all these are to be compared. So standard deviations, Sharpe ratio, etc. are to be compared across the category. In isolation, they don't mean anything. Expense ratio, as I said, lower the better, but not always necessary. But still, you can keep that as one of the parameters. But a few other things that you need to keep in mind are how much is the concentration within an industry and within a company. A spread out portfolio is generally a better idea, but not beyond, not too many stocks. So let's say around less than 30 stocks and you are taking concentration risk. Nothing wrong with taking risk. We've said risk is a choice. But spreading too much is you are avoiding risk. That also is not wrong. That also is a choice. Exposure to derivatives could add to your risk. So that's something that we need to keep in mind. Whenever there is an equity mutual funds are allowed to take derivatives exposure for the purpose of hedging or mirroring the index, etc. But whenever there is derivative exposure, you may want to be a little cautious and take a call. You can set your limits that, okay, beyond this limit, I'm not comfortable. So that's fine. Within debt funds, so this part is very, very similar, but on the risk measure, standard deviation is historical data. Credit quality, so AAA, AA, et cetera, is more forward-looking. What's the probability that you'll get the money in time, and there is enough interest rate that the paper is likely to pay. So that's also available through what is called the fund YTM. Duration actually adds to what kind of fluctuation you should expect going forward in debt markets. NAVs do fluctuate in debt markets, and liquidity is something that is difficult for us to measure. So I'll not put into it, but tell you what to do there. However, all the three risks are captured in the riskometer. And that's where riskometer makes the job relatively easier. Expense ratio matters more in debt funds than equity funds. And of course, on the portfolio composition, if there are pass-through certificates, finance company papers, or real estate papers, what you can simply do is consider them slightly riskier than what the credit rating indicates, because these papers often become riskier when there is stressed situation. But while selecting, there's a I could not make it shorter than that. But look at the role of each mutual fund scheme that you've taken in your portfolio. So there are primarily three objectives that any investor has: safety, liquidity, and returns. If you are looking for high returns, then safety and liquidity would be lower. If you're looking at liquidity and safety, then the returns would be on a lower side. So strike a balance between the three. For all your short-term needs, your primary objective is liquidity. For medium-term needs, the primary objective could be safety. And for long-term needs, the primary objective could be returns. Along with the primary objective of returns, you may have secondary objective of safety, which is perfectly fine and required. But when you are seeking high returns with reasonable safety, then another scheme which is high returns and low safety may generate higher returns in future. So you're probably compromising something, and that's how you I would say you are evaluating. And the last point where I would just cut it by a bit. Just give me a moment. When you look at the last point is about evaluating the fund house, you also, because it's a team of players that you want to see, look at the brand reputation, because somebody who's got a strong brand reputation would like to protect that brand reputation, so would not do something silly, something stupid, or be more careful. So that's one. However, don't go by the halo effect. Don't only go by the name. sometimes that could be quite deceptive. Look at stability of team, and I'm talking about the fund management team. How long have they been with the scheme? This data is available in the scheme information document as well as the fund fact sheet. In both the cases, this data is available. How long has the current manager, fund manager managing a particular scheme? That data is also available. Look for any period longer than 3 years or 5 years, and you should be fine. If you look at somebody who's been, you know, changing jobs, you don't know whether even the best of the guys, whether that person will be serving in your investment horizon or not. So look for stability is important. Complaints report is available on the website of each mutual fund as well as MFI. Annually, this report is to be filed. Look at the number of comparison in number of complaints in comparison to the total number of folios and how soon the complaints are resolved. So this available data is available each fund house's website. You know their approach towards funds and the sort of quality of service also can be judged by this data. At the same time, how good is their communication? Go to the website, look at the way the documents are structured, the quality and relevance of that communication. Are they putting enough number of messages? And some once you invest, that there's some who keep sending regular updates through email. Now, a lot of times we ignore those emails, but once in a while, it's good to check whether the communication is good quality communication or not, whether it makes sense or not, whether they are talking to people like us, common investors, or they are only talking to, you know, talking in the industry jargons or technical language. So that's something that I would really assess. Also, I mean, if you really want to spend a little more time, then listen to the interviews that the fund management team may be giving or read various interviews that come in. So with that, I'll, I mean, I know I exceeded the time that Nikhil had given me, but yeah, Nikhil, over to you now. Based on this brief discussion, we can start the conversation further.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.